Miracle Grow. Not as good as manure, but I thought if I put a picture of manure, y'all get confused. So just say, I didn't know what else to put. So today, I start with that because I don't want anybody to think you're not included in the sermon today. The sermon is about the sower, but I want you to understand that even when you get to the last stage of good soil, it still includes all of us. And like he said in that passage, at this time, you should be teachers, but you're still on milk. And so no matter what stage you're at, it's important that you understand that there's still that challenge to produce fruit. I brought a fruit tree. It's the only one I could find. I put the kind of fruit that I eat, though. I got York peppermint, Kit Kat, you know, the good fruit. The fruit that is actually enjoyable for all of us. And I'm reading through that, I think we so often forget when we go through the parable of the sower, just the idea of a tree filled with fruit. And fruit has a little bit changed since back then. We think of fruit, and that's one of the things you eat to be healthy. But if you take it back to older society, you realize that fruit is a real blessing. You know, fruit, you know, your normal stuff is you've got your bread and you've got your vegetables. And fruit was your dessert. Fruit is the dessert. Fruit is that thing that you love. So to translate it to us, it probably makes more sense to say candy. Because you don't want to think of fruit and get this negative idea like you're supposed to. This is that fruit that's just joy. This is that fruit that's love. This is that fruit that's peace. This is that fruit that's righteousness. This is a beautiful fruit. And today we're going to be in Mark chapter 4, talking about miracle grower. Mark 4, starting in verse 1. Again, he began to teach beside the sea, and a very large crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea. And the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. And he was teaching them many things in parables. And in his teaching, he said to them, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seed fell on rocky ground where it did not have much soil, and immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seed fell into good soil and produced grain, growing up and increasing, yielding 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And he said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." He starts by telling this parable, and the setting is such that he's just declared his disciples to be his family. And then he goes into this parable about the Word of God, and the Word of God going out, and the different places that it finds, and that soil. But he does it all in a parable. He does it in a parable, and most parables don't tell you why he's doing this in a parable. This is one of the only exceptions. This one tells you why he's telling it to you in a way that could easily be confused. He's talking about seeds and then growing and producing a lot, and sometimes it not producing a lot. And we look at back at it and we say, well, since we already know the end of the story, it makes sense. Since we already know the Word of God being the seed, it makes sense. But he says why he tells this parable in verse 10. And when he was alone, those who were around him with the 12 asked him about the parables. And he said to them, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see, but not perceive, and may indeed hear, but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven." And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables?" And then in verse 14, he gives the explanation. He says, "The sower sows the word. And these are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown. And these are the ones on the rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy. They have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are the ones sown among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit, 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. Today we are all at some stage in this, and we started by breaking this down to make sure it's clear. This is different stages. Good soil is not just one stage. But in all of us, we face one of those, and we need to focus where we are. Because there is nothing that says if you sit in a magic pew, you are instantly good soil. I know, the seat buttons are broken this morning, so if you sit down, it's not magic soil anymore. You're still sitting on a piece of wood with cloth on it. And it changed nothing. There is nothing to say that any of these are not you today, and there is nothing to say that once you have the word, that none of these apply to you anymore. You fit somewhere on this scale. Now the path is where you hear the word, and immediately you dismiss it. It's immediately dismissed. Satan's got a better plan for you. You have the rocky ground. When you first heard about God, you were real excited. And right now, if I ask you if you were excited, you've already showed me the answer.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I like that song.
No, and the thing is, you were so excited, and then it got a little bit hard. And when it got hard, it wasn't that Satan just came at you punching. It was little pricks. It was this little attack, this little pinch, this little get. And that fire that was once in you, it's not the same. You've got those in the thorns who you have that word, and you've got it and everything else, but you have to admit, of the 5 billion things you're thinking of this morning, one of them is Jesus. One of them is what's going on here, and the rest of your mind is off. And the desire, the cares, and everything in life. You've got a desire for God's word, but it doesn't say you must have a desire for it. It doesn't say if you have some desire for God's kingdom, everything will be taken care of. It doesn't say that. It says, if you seek the kingdom first, if you seek it first, then God supplies your needs. If you seek the kingdom first, if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, it doesn't say if one of your cares happens to be the word, then you've got 100 other cares on your mind. And then there's the good soil. And those are those who receive the word, and they receive God's blessing, and they bear fruit. And those can look at their lives, and they can say, well, I know what the fruit of the Spirit is. I know the fruit that God's talking about is more like candy than fruit. It's that thing that you wait for. There are certain fruits that I just love to eat. And then there are certain fruits that I'm supposed to eat. Oranges have vitamin C. Lemons have vitamin C. I don't enjoy them. How many of you honestly go and pop open a lemon? I'm not, thank you. I'm not the only one here. In Texas, this is very normal. Everybody likes to eat lemons. That's why they're so gruff. But you know, they'll eat these lemons. I never enjoyed it to the same level I enjoyed them. A banana's all sweet. A pineapple is sweet. And then you get these citrus fruits, and I'm not even a big fan. You know, I don't get the same joy out of them. I don't bake a cake out of lemon. Shana brought in lemon squares this morning. I'm glad y'all enjoyed those. If she brought in banana squares, okay, I mean, now we're talking a little fried bananas. plantain. That's the kind of fruit I want you to imagine. And I want you to think about this a second. And I know that we look at this and we're seeing this really spiritual side of going, oh, berry fruit. And we're thinking about, oh, it's good. This fruit is, you know, putting out the word and it's doing great things. I don't want you to get there yet. I want you to look at you. I want you to look at you and say, I'm the tree. What's my fruit? Not about sharing the fruit yet or anything, but the fruit you have right now. Are you filled with the fruit of the Spirit? It's only one type. It covers multiple facets, but it's only one type. Love. Are you filled with it? And how good does it feel to be filled with love? Joy. The very definition of joy is happy feelings of amazing beyond happiness. Glad we can make a simple definition for that. Peace. How many of us would like some peace? You know, none of this stress, the cares of the world. What was that one? Thorns or cares of the world. You've got cares of the world, but you've got peace. Patience. You're not frustrated continually because the person in front of you likes to go the speed limit. It's just a suggestion. You're not frustrated because, you know, there's four people in line and no other cashier's coming over here and I gotta wait on this guy. I had to get behind the guy who thinks that 40 items is 20. How nice would it be to know that you've got a patience that you go, yeah, 40's close to 20, I can round. That's okay, I'll get out here at some point. Kindness. How would it feel with a desire of kindness? When you're feeling so good that you just, you know, you share it. Hey, I want you to feel good too. I want to be kind to you. I want to love on you. I just want to share what I've got with you. Gentleness. None of that rage, none of that craziness. But a gentleness, an ability to just be so in control that you can be gentle with others. And faithfulness. A faithfulness in which you're so close to God that you're communing with God and you have that relationship and that blessing goes back and forth and back and forth. And you don't pray to God, you pray with God. You don't pray at God, you pray with God. And you're praying and you don't feel like you're hitting a wall. You don't feel like you're shouting at a ceiling. You are talking to the true God. You are talking to the God of the universe who is patiently listening to you. And self-control. To know that everything is under enough control inside of you that chaos on the outside is okay. You got a chaotic world you have no control over. You have no predictive ability. In 6 months, you have no clue what's going to happen. You don't know what's happening tomorrow. You can't even tell me what's happening tonight. And yet, if you have a self-control, it doesn't matter that there's chaos on the outside. Because you're having control on the inside. You know that everything is right with you and with your Lord, and you're leaning on all those things, and your tree looks like this. You've got these fruits that are beautiful and enjoyable. And this offering to have all this, and what do? We look at that and go, I can't have that. I can't have that. I can't do that. To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside, everything is in parables. So they may need see but not perceive, and may need hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven. I told you there's a temptation in Christ's life that too many people follow him. He needs at least enough people to hate him to kill him. Otherwise he can't fulfill his mission. Otherwise he cannot do the greatest thing for us. But in the middle of that you see that God is choosing you. And if God is choosing you, it makes it a really blasphemous statement to say what God can do with you. To say, I can't experience, it's not in me. I'm not a patient person. I am really, let's take this real personal, I'm not a gentle person. at all. I don't enjoy gentleness. And yet, the question is, can I produce a fruit of gentleness? The answer is no. The answer is yes. The answer is schizophrenia. Because here's what it is. God, through me, can produce fruit of the Spirit. He can take His Word that is sown in me. I am the soil, and I can be the soil bearing fruit to 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. Him, through me, can do that. And we sit here with our trying and striving and cares and concerns and wherever you're fitting on this thing, and you're saying, what do you really want? Do you want something that is better than temporary happiness? Do you want something that is better than what this world can offer? And if you do, why don't you have it? It's offered free. It's offered in His Spirit. And so we are offered this to have this love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. And He offers that to all of us. And we have to look at ourselves as a stream and say, which would feel better? Which would be better for us? Don't even be concerned at this moment about the world outside us who needs us to be a tree producing fruit. Which tree do you want to be? Would you rather come in here and you seriously can't figure out which way your frown is supposed to face? I really think it may be better for me some Sunday mornings if y'all would sit upside down. And it would work a little better. Because here's the question. If God said He's giving you joy through His Spirit and you don't have it, guess who's the problem? God ran out? Did God run out? It's no, no. I'm not preaching myself. Y'all are good. Y'all are here too. Two people. If God doesn't run out, then where's the issue? Us, right? It's me. It's the difference between me deciding that, you know what, I need to see where I'm at. I need to look at this parable and see what's troubling me. Am I letting things of this world, tribulations, persecutions, problems in my day get me so down that I'm saying, yeah, here's that stuff that God gave me. You can just take it away. It's rocky soil. Well, what was it? Them birds, right? Them birds come and take it away. Because we just give it away. We say, oh, I've got problems, I've got struggles. Just take my joy away. Take it. It was from God, and you can have it. Or, looking at this soil, are we so concerned about everything in this life that goes away? How many of you drive a car? How many of y'all think you're going to have to fix something in the next 6 months? You're like, yeah. Tires, they always go bad. This state requires 4 brakes on a car. I mean, you got to have a windshield with no cracks. The thing runs out of gas. It's going to have problems. It's going to go and get worse, and there's going to be something wrong with it. And are you so focused on the riches of this earth that are just like that car? Your money's not worth what it was a year ago. Sorry. It's the fact. Yeah, your possessions, that house that was so nice, is slowly decaying. That car that breaks down is breaking down. And all those riches. And is your concern so on those riches that when God offers you a richness that He says, I'm going to give you joy, and in 2 days it's going to be bigger. He says, I'm going to offer you joy, and it's going to be greater a year from now. I'm going to offer you peace, and it will be worth more and more and more. Every day we live on this earth, those fruits become worth more and more to us. That joy and that hope becomes so big the closer we get to it. The closer we get to the end of this life, we start to realize the only things worth anything is those fruit. It's that fruit of the Spirit that God gives to us and He offers us freely, and we need to consider ourselves today. Where's our struggle? Because the hardest thing you're going to ever try to fight is an enemy you can't see.
when they challenged the nation of Israel,
Israel got nervous as usual.
And they said, we're all alone. And then an angel said to him, open your eyes. And he looks around and there's a host of angels ready to fight for him. And those enemies of Israel didn't have a chance. They couldn't even see who they were facing. And when we don't know who we're facing, it becomes near impossible to fight. Because we first got to be wanting something more. We need to want to be fruit like that tree. Because once we are filled with that fruit, we will bless others. There is no question. It's not like I'll go, well, once I have God and I'm excited about God, then I'll need to share it with others. I don't know how many times Ginger's going to tell everybody that she has a grandbaby. Why is she doing that? Because someone told her to, right? I bet it was one of them elders. They're like, keep saying you have a grandbaby. No, she's excited about that. If we're excited about God, we're going to bear fruit, and then we're going to just want to share it. And it won't be a matter of, I need to share the faith. It'll be, I want to tell you what's with me. I want to tell you the fruit that he's putting in me, and look at my tree. This is awesome. Look what he's doing. Today we have this invitation, and this invitation applies to all of us at some level. You may be one who has heard the word, but you honestly, you've given up on all that. You said, you know, God's offering some really great stuff. God is offering eternal life. God is offering a life abundant here. And Satan's got a different plan for you. And that's the one that just goes bad in me. You may be one of those who's struggling with concerns. And there's so many hard things in your life that you're not giving to God. And so it's just robbing your joy. You've got those persecutions, you've got those struggles, and you won't give it to Him, so you've got to deal with it. You may be amongst yourself the problem. You're so concerned with everything in your life that you haven't got time for God. But the other one is this. You may be that good soil, and you've let yourself stay on the milk. You never even wanted it in the first place. You never wanted to become the teacher. You never wanted to be filled with the same fruit of the Spirit. And you let something else rob your joy. It's you this time. So today's invitation is this. If you have not received Christ, believing in Him, confessing Him, repenting of your sins, being buried with Him in baptism, raised up in a new life, so that you can walk with Him. We offer that invitation. And if you need prayers, and you need to release it all to God so you can get that joy back, because something on that list, that's where your joy went. So today, it's back in our court, because we know the Lord calls, but yet there is this line, if anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. It begins with this passage, it ends with this passage. If you have ears, hear. Today we offer that invitation. And we also offer, if you'd like to submit to the eldership here, that you come now as we stand and as we sing.